Is Costco a store or is it something else? And why does it matter? Answers to those questions and a lot more starting right now.
This is Debt Free in 30. Here's your host, Doug Hoyes.
Today I want to talk about a wonderful, magical place called Costco. And I'll explain what Costco can teach us about personal finance. Now, I'm not going to tell you how to save money at Costco. I want to start by asking a question. What is Costco? Now, you may think that's an easy question. Costco is a store. They sell stuff. That's true, but Costco doesn't make money selling stuff, and I'll prove it. And then I'll explain why understanding how Costco really makes their money has a big impact on how we should make financial decisions. And for those of you who normally listen to the audio version of this podcast, you may want to jump over to the Debt Free in 30 YouTube channel, because for today's episode, I've got lots of data I'll put on the screen to prove my point. So back to the wonderful world of Costco. You all know what it is. It's this massive store that has a massive warehouse full of every item imaginable. It's a wonderful, magical place. But what is Costco? I know the conventional wisdom is, well, it's a store, they sell stuff. But today I'm going to show you that no, that's not how they make their money, and I'll prove it because I'm an expert. Yes, I'm an expert. I'm a chartered accountant, a chartered professional accountant, a licensed insolvency trustee. I'm an expert in analyzing financial statements and really figuring out what's going on, and that's what I'm going to do today. We're going to start by taking a look at Costco's annual report so we can see the real numbers. When you look at Costco's annual report, their financial statements, you see that their net sales are $138 billion, and that's US dollars. But when you read further down into their financial statements, you see that their merchandise costs are $123 billion. That's the stuff they buy that they then resell. They've also got selling, general, and administrative expenses of another $14 billion, which means that their operating income, the money they make from selling stuff, is only $1 billion. Now, you might think, wow, $1 billion, that's a lot of money. Well, if your net sales are $138 billion, that's a lot of work to earn $1 billion. That is not how Costco makes their money. They break even selling products. And yet, if you read right to the end of their financial statements, you will see that they made a profit of over $3 billion. So how did they make $3 billion in profit when they're basically break-even selling stuff? Well, you may know the answer, but let's flow it through and see if you got it right. Let me propose this theory. Costco is a bank. Costco is a finance company. They go out and buy massive quantities of stuff, you know, like toilet paper, for example, and they buy it by the truckload, and they stack it up in their warehouse. You've been there, you've seen it, it's all over the place. And they get credit terms. So they go to the toilet paper supplier and they say, here's the deal. We're going to buy stuff from you, but we're not going to pay for it for 90 days. And of course, the suppliers say, well, Costco, you sell $138 billion of stuff every year. We got to keep you happy. So fine, no problem. We will grant you 90-day credit terms. So the shipment of toilet paper arrives on day one, and Costco puts it on the floor and in the warehouse and on their racks, and they very quickly sell it. Maybe it takes 2-3 days and they've sold that whole truckload of toilet paper. And that's why, of course, when you go to Costco, you can't just buy one roll. You have to buy the mega pack, you know, that has, I don't know, 50, 100, 1,000 rolls of toilet paper in it. Why? Because Costco wants to sell it really quickly so they can put the money in their bank and then invest it. So if they buy it on day one and sell it on day three and don't have to pay for it until day number 90, that means they've got 87 days of your money in their bank account earning interest. And it's not just, of course, one truckload of toilet paper. They sell $138 billion worth of stuff. So they've got billions and billions of dollars at all times sitting in their bank account. They can sell everything at cost, not make any money selling stuff, and still make over $3 billion. Why am I telling you this? Well, it's important to understand the game, how it works. Normally, when you go into a store, you think, well, it's all about price. How much am I paying? It's all about volume. How many things am I buying? But of course, at Costco, it's different. They want you to fill your cart, and so you think you're getting a good price, but did you actually get a good deal? The questions you got to ask yourself when you go to a place like Costco are, okay, what was the price? And that's sometimes difficult because if you go to the grocery store and buy the 12-pack of toilet paper, you know what that costs. But when you buy the 50-pack, do you know what that's supposed to cost? Do you actually figure it out per roll of toilet paper? Well, no, you probably don't. Do you think about, where am I going to store all this toilet paper that I just bought? Do you think about the opportunity cost? That's an economics term that means the money that I spend on this thing, I can't now spend on that thing. I just made a significant investment in toilet paper, which means if, I don't know, chicken goes on sale next week, I'm not going to be able to buy it because I've invested all my money in toilet paper. Do you ask these rational questions when you go to Costco? Probably not, because we make our financial decisions based on emotion, not logic. That's just the way we humans work. The conventional wisdom is Costco has good prices. Now, do they? Well, as I said, unless you're actually figuring it out on a per unit basis, you don't actually know if they do. But we go to Costco and our emotion takes over and we think, hey, I'm getting a good deal. I'm buying in bulk. I've got this fear of missing out. I want to make sure I'm getting a deal. So I buy it. Now, is that rational? Is a shopping cart full of toilet paper a rational decision? Good question. You see, when you're making a buying decision, it should be a rational decision. You should be thinking about price, quality, what features I'm getting, how reliable it is. You know, I mean, if you're buying something big and expensive, is there a warranty on it? But of course, that's not how we do it. We make our decisions based on emotion. Hey, how does it look? How does it make me feel? Does it enhance my sense of self-esteem? Do I like that brand? Now, obviously, it doesn't apply to toilet paper, but is there a safety factor if I buy this? Or is there a fear of missing out if I don't buy it? Those are often the emotional triggers we use to make buying decisions. So my question is, do you know the game? What other money decisions do we make based on emotion? And by making decisions based on emotion, does that get us into debt? Does that cause us problems? Well, this, of course, is what I talked about in my book, Straight Talk on Your Money. And yes, you were wondering when the commercial for my book would come. Well, there you go. I talked about this in Straight Talk on Your Money, and I made the point that we make decisions based on sales pitches, based on emotion, based on conventional wisdom. We buy car insurance, right? What is car insurance? Well, it's not really car insurance. It's really accident insurance, but we don't call it that. We get health insurance. Well, it's not really health insurance. It's sickness insurance, but we don't call it that. That wouldn't be emotionally satisfying. And yeah, I'm one of those guys who still has the old card. I never did get around to replacing it. We buy life insurance, but of course, it's not really life insurance. It's death insurance. It's insuring you against death. But if it was called death insurance, would you actually go out and buy it? Well, no, of course not. That's not a very happy sounding thing. Life insurance sounds much happier. You know those plastic things you carry in your wallet? What do you call them? Well, you call them credit cards. Why do you call them credit cards? Well, because credit is a positive, emotionally satisfying thing. Hey, I like to give credit where credit is due. Well, of course, what they really are is debt cards. These are cards that allow you to get into debt. But if we called them debt cards, would you be happy to use them? Of course not. Now, frankly, I think it's a good idea to call them debt cards, because if every time you went to the store and bought something and said, well, I'm going to pay for it with my debt card, perhaps we'd think twice about buying stuff. And of course, the cashier would look funny at you. I'm not talking about debit cards. I'm talking about debt cards, which is really what we should call credit cards. But of course, we don't, because that's not emotionally satisfying. I also, in my book, talked about one of the myths. Myth number three was that experts are experts. Okay, everyone kind of agrees with that. You know, if I've got a medical problem, I want to go see a doctor. Hopefully a doctor that's credible. If I have a car problem, I want to go see a mechanic because that's the expert when it comes to cars. And if I've got a financial issue, well, I want to talk to some financial expert, a financial planner, or whomever, because experts are experts. They're able to help me. Well, are experts always experts? Are bankers experts? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe they're just trying to sell you something when they go to the bank. Maybe they don't actually have your best interests in hearts at heart. That's why you should never blindly rely on an expert's advice. You should question everything. You should do your own research and be aware of the sales tricks like we just talked about. And in fact, I've just played a sales trick on you. I started by telling you that I was a very qualified person. I'm a chartered accountant, a chartered professional accountant, all these fancy things. I've been doing this for a year. And then I used that preconceived notion of my expertise to tell you this wild, fantastic story about Costco. I told you that I looked at Costco's financial statements, so they have $138 billion in sales, but they only actually make about $1 billion from selling stuff. Well, that's actually true, but these are financial statements that I retyped. These aren't actually the financial statements the way Costco produces them. What I then told you, and this was where I kind of fudged it a little bit, was I said that Costco is really a finance company. They make their money by selling stuff, putting it in the bank, earning interest, and that's how they make their money. Well, if you actually look at their financial statements, you see that the interest income they earned last year was $121 million. Okay, that's not an insignificant amount of money, but if you keep reading, you find that their interest expense was $159 million. That means they actually incurred more interest expense than what they earned, which is the way pretty much every business does it. I mean, I'm sure Costco is always out there opening new stores and buying inventory and buying, you know, racks to put all their toilet paper on. They borrow the money to do that, which is why their interest expense is higher than their interest income. Costco isn't a bank. Costco isn't a finance company. That's not how they make their money. And in fact, when you continue reading their financial statements, you see that they set aside $1.2 billion for income taxes, which means that after making $1.2 billion selling stuff and not making anything on interest and then paying $1.2 billion in taxes, they are essentially a break-even company. And in fact, they actually, on that basis, lost $8 million last year. But I did tell you that Costco actually made money last year. They made $3.3 billion. How did they do it? Well, they had another revenue source. They made $3.1 billion on something else. How did Costco do it? Well, if you've been following along, you've probably already figured it out. So instead of looking at the financial statements the way I retype them, let's take a look at the way they actually appear in the annual report. Yes, Costco had $138 billion worth of sales, and their other revenue of $3.1 million was membership fees. And that's how Costco made $3.1 billion last year. Membership fees. In fact, their entire profit last year was membership fees. Now, why does Costco charge a membership fee? That doesn't really make sense. That limits the number of potential customers they have. I mean, I can go to a grocery store and buy toilet paper or pretty much anything else that's sold at Costco. Why would I pay a membership fee for the privilege of shopping at a store? Doesn't that limit the number of potential people who come shopping at your store? Well, here's the secret. Costco doesn't really care if you buy any stuff. They only care if you pay your membership fee because that's how they make all their money. Costco plays on your emotions. Ah, yes, here we go, back to emotions. At Costco, they don't call you a customer, they call you a member. And that's why you have to pay a membership fee. And of course, being a member is much better than being a customer. I mean, if I'm a customer, I don't have any loyalty to the store. But if I'm a member, oh, that's totally different, right? I'm a member of the club. And of course, as with any other club, well, there's a membership card. You could be a business member or a Gold Star member or an executive member, but it doesn't matter. You get this secret card and that makes you a member of the club. Have you ever noticed when you go to Costco that the stores, the front door is not very impressive at all? I mean, you're walking into a warehouse. It's not fancy. There's not all sorts of bright lights and gold leaf and everything. No, in fact, it's kind of dark. Why would a multi-billion dollar company have a front door that looks like you're going into a warehouse? Well, because that's exactly what they want. You have to drive there. You can't take the bus to Costco because you're going to be carrying home 500 rolls of toilet paper. You got to have a car. You got to park in their huge parking lot. You got to walk in. And then when you go into this narrow door, it's kind of dark. And you got to hold out your membership card. And there's always a bit of apprehension when you get there because you're hoping, gee, did I forget my membership card? And boy, I sure hope it didn't expire. I want to make sure I can still get in here. And so you get in that little line and you grab your shopping cart. And finally, the person at the front door says, yes, you can come in. Congratulations. And then all of a sudden, you're as soon as you show them your membership card, you're in this massive warehouse. It's not a dark little dingy entryway. No, no. The ceilings are three stories high. It's very brightly lit and there's stuff all over the place. It gives you a bit of an adrenaline rush. I mean, there's a shot of dopamine or something that goes, wow, I finally made it into the club. Now I want to buy stuff. And that's why when you go to Costco, you always leave with a full shopping cart. I mean, very few people I've ever met go to Costco and buy one thing. I have met a couple of people who told me they did do that, but in most cases, you're spending hundreds and hundreds of dollars when you go to Costco. They've psyched you up for that. You're a member, now you get to spend money, and that's why you, of course, fill your shopping cart with a whole bunch of everything. So, back to the central question. What is Costco? It's not a store. Okay, yeah, I get it. It sells stuff, but that's not how they make their money. And no, they're not a bank or a finance company like I told you. They are a club. Costco is a membership club. Costco wants you to pay $60 or $120 for the Executive Gold Star membership because that's how they make their money. So, what's my point? What can we learn from Costco? Well, number one, we should understand the game. You should understand that Costco wants you to be a member. They don't really care if you buy stuff. That's the key to Costco's success. So what does it mean to be a member? Well, you're part of this exclusive club. If your friend isn't a member of Costco, they don't get to shop here. Now, if you're a member of this exclusive club, does that mean that you buy more than you need because you're in the club? Does it mean you don't comparison shop? I don't see too many people at Costco with their calculators out figuring out whether the 50-pack of toilet paper is costing them less than if they had just bought the same toilet paper in a 12-pack at a regular grocery store. Sometimes stuff, I'm sure, is cheaper at Costco, but it wouldn't surprise me if there were other times where it's more expensive. But you get caught up in the adrenaline of it, and you're not really making rational decisions when you go to Costco. And of course, there's the free samples. Nothing wrong with that, but hey, I got something for free. Maybe I'll buy it whether I need it or not. Costco doesn't want you to make rational decisions. They want you to use your emotions. Now, of course, so does everyone else. I'm not bashing Costco here because that's how everyone does it. And that's what we can learn from Costco. They want you to use your emotions, not your rational decision-making ability. You got to understand that it is playing on your emotions that's how they make their money, and then you can govern yourself accordingly. Let me give you a couple of other examples about how people make their money. We talked about banks. How do banks make their money? Well, banks are pretty simple. You put money in a savings account and they loan it out to someone else and that's how they make their money. Okay, perhaps I'll do a longer podcast about how banks actually make their money. The point is, when you go to the bank and go up and talk to a customer service representative, what we used to call a teller, you are talking to a salesperson. They don't want to just accept your deposit or give you your money or whatever it is you're there for. They want to sell you a mutual fund or insurance or whatever else. They're there to sell you. Why does that matter? Well, because you're off guard when you go to a bank. You don't think that you're being sold to. You think you're going to a bank. When you understand that the customer service representatives are really salespeople, makes it a little easier to see through what they're doing. What about your financial planner? How does your financial planner make money? We've talked about this a few times on the show before. There are some financial planners that are fee-only financial planners. They charge you a set rate and they'll give you advice. Fantastic. They're not very biased then when they do that, right? They're just trying to help you. But there are other financial planners who don't charge you any fees, but they're getting their fees from the mutual funds that you buy. That's how they make their money. Is that a good thing or a bad thing? Well, I guess it's neither, but you want to at least understand how someone is getting compensated, and that way you can decide whether or not it makes sense for you to be dealing with that person or not. The key point, of course, is you want to be making rational decisions. You should pay for something if it's worth it, and you shouldn't pay for something just because you want to be in the club. And of course, that really helps Costco. You want to stay as a member, so I better get value for my membership. I better buy lots of stuff, whether I need it or not. Final point, don't automatically trust experts. I mean, I told you that Costco wasn't a store. Well, I guess I was right about that. But then I also told you Costco was a financial company. Well, no, that's not really true either. They're a membership company. And just because I said I was a chartered accountant and a CPA and told you all about my experience doesn't mean you should blindly accept what I'm saying. Now, fortunately, I did show you the financial statements so you could confirm for yourself what the truth was, but that's the way you got to make decisions. You got to dig a little bit deeper and see what's really happening. That's what Costco can teach us about money, debt, and financial management. That's our show for today. Don't miss an episode. Subscribe on iTunes, Apple Podcasts, or wherever you get your podcasts. You can listen on Spotify. And to watch, be sure to subscribe to the Debt Free in 30 channel on YouTube. And if you like the podcast, please leave a review. That's our show for today. Thanks for listening. Until next week, I'm Doug Hoyes. That was Debt Free in 30.